We're now live in the LD UK Facebook group with Bob Miller. Bob Miller is a certified traditional naturopath with 20 plus years of practice. He is also the founder and practitioner at the Tree of Life, a practice in Ephrata. Thank you. I had no idea how to pronounce that. That offers a wide array of naturopathic and holistic health services. For the past several years, Bob has been engaged with genetic variants and related research and is astounded at how many people's health concerns are related to genetic issues. In 2015, Bob founded the Nutrigenetic Genetic Research Institute to research and publish reports on the relationship between genetic variants and labs and presenting symptoms. His first project was to research if those with chronic Lyme disease had unique genetic patterns that may predisposition them to their health challenges. Hi Bob, welcome to Lyme Disease UK.
It's a pleasure to be with you folks.
Well, thank you so much for giving up your time. We really do appreciate it. We're going to go through some questions that have been pre-submitted. And I guess the first one really is, how did you get interested in helping those people with Lyme disease?
Well, it's interesting. It was somewhat serendipitous. I don't have Lyme. No one in my family has Lyme. But I just started seeing a few clients who had Lyme disease. And I was asked to speak at a support group, and some of those folks came. And then, you know, with Facebook today, people started talking, and all of a sudden I found myself inundated, you know, across the world with people with Lyme disease. And what I found quite fascinating was that from a genetic standpoint, many of them had patterns that started looking similar. And we'll talk about that as we go along. And it was because of that I decided that perhaps some research is needed here. And that's why I created the Research Institute, just a small organization that I started. And we gathered data from individuals with Lyme and started doing some studies. So that's how it all began.
So it sounds like the patients very much came to you and found you then. That's fascinating. Just before we touch on, you touched on patterns there that you started seeing. Just before I ask about that, could I ask you just to explain for people out there what the difference is between genetics, epigenetics, and so forth? And, you know, just because you have a genetic marker, will that definitely be impacting your health? And what impact epigenetics and nutrigenomics plays into that, please?
Sure. Okay. Well, let's start go back with a little bit of genetics 101. You know, our DNA comes 50% from our mother, 50% from our father. And we have hundreds of thousands of genes. And the purpose of these genes is to provide instructions on how to make things in the body. What I like to say is, you know, we get our fats, carbohydrates, proteins. We breathe air, we drink water, we're exposed to sunlight. And through, you know, absolutely miraculous processes, you know, we take substance A, whatever that is, we bring in some cofactors and an enzyme, and that enzyme comes from our DNA. So our DNA is instructions on how to make enzymes. So substance A, substance B and C, and an enzyme equals substance C. And if we inherit the right DNA from our parents, that works flawlessly. However, we can get what are called a genetic variants or SNPs or polymorphisms, all the same thing, where the DNA has a protein swap at the end, and therefore it either doesn't make the right kind of enzyme or it doesn't make enough of the enzyme. So consequently, that substance A plus cofactors doesn't quite work. Okay. So we don't get enough of something, and that might be trimethylglycine that we need to do some important purposes. It might be that we're not making our neurotransmitters. It may not be that we're making a very powerful antioxidant called glutathione. I mean, literally everything that happens in the body is because our DNA has instructions on how to do that. And as we have genetic variants from our parents, then we don't make the enzymes and processes go awry. Now, clearly that's been happening for a long time. And we don't exactly know how these genetic variants occurred, but they did, maybe spontaneously, maybe through some virus. There's some thought that know, a long time ago when venereal diseases were running rampant, that may have altered the DNA in some way. It really doesn't much matter, but we all have altered DNA. We're never going to find someone who doesn't have, you know, some variants in their DNA. So that means some processes may not work appropriately. Now, we're pretty incredible. We have backup systems inside the body. And if one thing doesn't work, something else will compensate. Sometimes there's two ways something can happen. So that's our genetics. And if we have a genetic issue, you know, we may not be making enough of the enzymes. A process may not be working properly. For the most part, we can compensate for that. Or, you know, we may just age a little more quickly or be more susceptible to something. Now, epigenetics is our environment, what we're exposed to. And one of the sayings that's quite popular in the genetic world is that genetics loads the gun and environment pulls the trigger. And we are living in an environment that our ancestors never lived in. One time I heard a very well-known medical professional say, if I was born today, I'd likely be autistic. So the question becomes, what are we doing to our environment? And I'm certainly not trained in environmentalism, but I don't think it's a stretch to say that, you know, we are putting out so many new chemicals that we don't know the long-term effects of them. So we have chemicals we're exposed to. We have herbicides and pesticides. We have our furniture degassing, all kinds of industrial solvents. Even our homes, you know, we might be sleeping on something that's giving off gases. We're putting things on our lawns. We're modifying our foods. And we really don't know. And I'm not pointing any fingers at anything. I'm just pointing this out as a potential theory. But we're being exposed to all kinds of toxins that we were never exposed to. Any one of them may not be all that bad for us. But the question that arises, and probably we'll know the answer to this in 50 to 60 years, is what is it, an accumulation of those that overwhelmed us? You know, you can find studies that show that when babies are in the womb, they're being exposed to industrial chemicals from the blood from the mother. So the question becomes, and again, not a statement, just a question for scientific research, has the accumulation of environmental toxins we're exposed to, you know, hurting those that are genetically the weakest? I tend to think that's something we tend to research. If I had to guess, I think that's what we're going to find, that those who have the least desirable genetic pattern, that they're able to detox poisons, that they're able to clear things, that they have enough antioxidants, and then on top of that are exposed to a lot of environmental toxins, are the ones that may be the weakest and more susceptible to many of the things that we're seeing today. So again, to summarize it, your genetics is what you inherit. That doesn't change. And, you know, if you like, we can address the expressed or not expressed, but I wanted to see if that answered your question on genetics versus epigenetics.
Absolutely. And I think it's really important for people to understand that distinction, because I don't think it's always understood. You talked about the patterns in those expressions that you began to see when you started looking at patients who had chronic Lyme disease. Are you able to tell us a bit about what you discovered?
Sure. And let me first mention, I'm a traditional naturopath, so I'm non-medical. So I actually have clients rather than patients. And I'm probably the biggest person that sees, or I have the biggest amount of client load of people with Lyme who doesn't treat the Lyme. I know you've had medical professionals on here who are the licensed medical folks who treat the Lyme disease. They try to find the medication or herbal or whatever else that actually kills the pathogen. As a traditional naturopath, I don't do that. I am the complementary guy that supports the function of the body. And you're seeing that in cancer clinics. You'll see the folks that are doing the radiation and the chemo, the doctors are doing that. And then there's nutritionists and naturopaths that work on the environment. So I want to be clear, I don't treat Lyme disease, despite the fact that 80% of my practice is consulting with clients who have Lyme disease. And I have physicians who are treating Lyme say, you need to go talk to Bob, because when I give you treatment, I'm sure everyone's familiar with the concept Herxheimer, mm-hmm. You know, they can't handle the treatment, because when they try to kill the pathogens, the person becomes so sick and toxic because their pathways are not open. Now, back to your question of what pattern am I seeing? Now, let's go back to Naturopathy 101. And this goes all the way back to the very beginning. You know, when we looked at the argument of the pathogen, and do we need to kill the germ? That's called the germ theory. And then that would be the, you know, the premise of basically modern medicine of let's find the pathogen and kill it. And back at the same time that the germ theory was being proposed, there was another scientist who said, well, yes, there's a germ, but we have to look at the environment of the body that allows that pathogen to thrive. And quite some time ago, that whole theory kind of got pushed aside, and now it's being looked at again, basically with functional medicine. In my opinion, functional medicine is medical doctors who are, you know, espousing to traditional naturopathic philosophies, and that is it's the environment of the body that allows the pathogen to have a more friendly environment. So that may be why, you know, one person gets bit by a tick and their immune system might fight it off. Another person gets bit by a tick and they do the antibiotics and they're fine. And then the third person gets bit by the tick, despite the best medical treatment, despite the most aggressive, they can't seem to fight it off and they're getting sicker and sicker. The theory that I'm proposing that clearly needs a lot of research, and that is, are these people compromised from both a genetic and an epigenetic standpoint? Do they have weak genetics that they don't make antioxidants, they don't clear poisons, they don't build things that makes their immune system strong, and then they may have been exposed to epigenetic factors. And perhaps, you know, they worked in an industry where they, you know, I oftentimes talk to car mechanics who were doing it for a long time. They didn't wear gloves, you know, or they were in the, you know, the airline mechanic, and they didn't wear gloves. Well, they used very strong chemicals. The other subgroup I'm seeing is folks who were like in Poland or near Chernobyl, and they have high levels of uranium inside of them, and this is weakening their immune system. So that's the theory that I'm proposing. Again, not saying this is happening. This is a theory, and that's why we have a research institute to research this. You know, are those that are chronically ill, do they have some combination of genetic and epigenetic factors that puts them at a disadvantage? So that's the theory that needs some research. That's why I created the Nutrigenetic Research Institute. Now, you ask, what patterns did we see? So again, let's go back to the naturopathic philosophy, and there's a couple of things that have to happen. We have to get nutrients into the body. They need to make energy, ATP, adenyl triphosphate. Then the body does its job, and in so doing so, it makes free radicals. And free radicals are electrons that spin off. And those electrons will do damage inside the body. That's the aging process. You know, it's interesting. If you look at someone, usually within 10 to 12 years, you can guess their age. Well, the reason you can is because you know what people look like at various phases of life. More wrinkles, grayer hair, more stooped over, you know, slowing down, those kind of things. Well, it's those free radicals that do that. And we need to make antioxidants that neutralize those free radicals. The three major ones that I look at are glutathione, superoxide dismutase, and catalase. So if we have genetic issues that we don't make enough of these antioxidants, and we have genetic patterns that might make more free radicals, or we're exposed to free radicals by being a smoker, by working in an environment where we're exposed to a lot of toxins, that may make a toxic environment where the immune system is suppressed. There's a substance called peroxynitrite that I'll speak about in a moment, antihydroxyl radicals. And those make the body toxic, deplete whatever antioxidants you have, and weaken the immune system. So for the person who genetically makes more free radicals, and if we have time, we'll talk about that. It's called NAS uncoupling. And then if they have a genetic pattern that they don't make the antioxidants needed to deal with that inflammation and peroxynitrite and hydroxyl radicals, and then on top of that, they're exposed to environmental toxins, they have detox pathways that are very compromised. So when a physician goes to give them a drug to kill the pathogen and the body tries to detox it out, they just get very sick. Or their immune system is weakened because of all this inflammation, particularly peroxynitrite, has been shown to weaken the immune system. So the pattern that I've seen, I'm sorry, do you have a question there?
No.
Okay, I thought I heard something on the speakers. So what happens then is they have weakened immunity, they're toxic, and consequently they're having a hard time recovering and making energy. That's the big picture. And now if you'd like, I can talk about the specific things we found. But to sum it up, they either don't make antioxidants, or they overproduce free radicals, or something else that doesn't clear toxins and or build the body. There's genetic variants that we don't make enough folate, and therefore we don't restore cells. And usually it's what we call the proverbial perfect storm. Many things coming together. And that's why I believe we're never going to find the Lyme gene. If someone's looking for the gene that makes you susceptible to Lyme, I think it's highly unlikely we're going to find it. It would be nice if life was so simple, but I don't think it is. My opinion at this point, and clearly that just opinion, it's complex. And I see various patterns, and if you'd like, we can get into that, the kind of different patterns. So I don't see a pattern for those that seem to be chronically ill. I see multiple patterns, but they all lead to the same thing. Many roads to the top of the mountain, or bottom of the valley perhaps, and that is that they're underproducing antioxidants, overproducing free radicals, exposed to environmental toxins. So if you like, we can go into those patterns, or perhaps you have another question.
No, I think that'd be good. It sounds as though this is what inspired you to start the research, and you know, if there's a way that you can explain what your theories and any findings that you're starting to get out of your research, what implications that has for treatment. So looking at those patterns, but with regards to what that means for the patient in terms of treatment, that would be really useful.
Okay, well, let's get into some patterns. Well, one of the first things I found in those with, and this is what actually piqued my interest, there's a gene called the HFE gene. And what it does, it regulates how we absorb iron. And what I just found anecdotally in my clinic when I was talking to these folks, as I talked to one client after another, I kept seeing these HFE genes, which means that they slightly overabsorb their iron. Now, there's a disease called hemochromatosis where you have like homozygous or double copies of these genes that, you know, on a couple of the genes you can inherit it from both mother and father, and you overabsorb iron tremendously. And your medical professional will find that by high levels of iron. And the treatment is phlebotomy, where they actually have to take blood from you. However, what I found in many of these people, they didn't have, you know, that, but they had several of these genes that the research has shown that they slightly absorb a little more iron. And, of course, you know, iron is incredibly important. There's people in parts of the country dying from, you know, anemia because of iron deficiency. And they desperately need iron either supplemented or, you know, in iron-rich foods, or they're going to die of anemia. However, in the industrialized world, we now have our foods are all fortified. And it's very rare to find that someone diet-wise is getting inadequate amounts of iron. I mean, it can happen in poverty, but for the most part, we're getting adequate amounts of iron. So what I found is that when these people have this pattern where they don't have the disease hemochromatosis, but they're overabsorbing a little bit of iron. And this is an area that we're putting most of our research on at the moment, because what I found in my phase one study that I presented in Helsinki, Finland last June, and actually was one of the research winners, was the people with chronic Lyme, when I compared them to the 1,000 Genome Project, which is like a standard of 1,000 people would be like, they had 500% more probability of having these HFE genes, which I found was pretty astonishing. Now, that in of itself probably isn't enough, because if you look at the literature, it'll tell you that, you know, some of these variants cause you to absorb a little bit more iron. And, you know, for most people, that may not be a bad idea. However, although iron is needed you know, for your for making your hemoglobin. And I mean, obviously, we don't have to get into why iron's important. It is, but anything can be in excess. And what we found is that, you know, some of these people were having excess iron absorption. Even that may not be a bad idea. However, what we found, and this is perhaps what we stumbled across, is that there's a very important antioxidant called glutathione. And it's the master antioxidant. And our glutathione levels bottom out at around age 85, and that's when people usually start degenerating. A study was done of people 101 to 105 who, you know, were still walking around and knew who they were. And we found that the only thing they could find medically with them is they had the average glutathione levels of a 50-year-old. So glutathione is what takes toxins out of your body. It's related to your immune system. When I give my lectures, I'll spend a good hour or two on the importance of glutathione. Well, glutathione is made from three amino acids, N-acetylcysteine, glycine, and glutamine. And many people are familiar with cysteine because many people will supplement with NAC, N-acetylcysteine, in an effort to make glutathione. And if you remember in the very beginning, I talked about how we need enzymes to take substance A and turn it into substance B, and so forth. And we can now map out the whole genetic process of how N-acetylcysteine, glycine, and glutamine turns into glutathione, the master antioxidant. And if everything's working well, and you take N-acetylcysteine, you're going to make more glutathione. But the second thing I found with many of these people is they had genetic issues that they had a hard time making their glutathione. So what that means is that that cysteine that's supposed to be turned into glutathione might be actually going a little bit on the high side. And there's something called the Fenton reaction, F-E-N-T-O-N, where cysteine combines with iron and makes the Fe3 turns to Fe2, and then that combines with hydrogen peroxide, and that'll be high if you don't have enough glutathione, and makes what are called hydroxyl radicals. And those are very inflammatory, and they damage the body. They have no purpose whatsoever. Some free radicals actually are used for the immune system and other things, but hydroxyl radicals have no good purpose. These people then get their glutathione depleted. They're inflamed. Even before they got Lyme, they were predisposition to inflammation. So what we found is that these people, in addition to having the iron issue, also did not convert their cysteine into glutathione properly. So then we had this perfect storm. Iron plus cysteine equals hydroxyl radicals. So that's one of the first things we found in those with chronic Lyme. Some people had that pattern. Now, the other pattern we found, and again, my initial findings, and these are, again, preliminary, there wasn't, here's the pattern for those with chronic Lyme. There was another pattern we saw related to something called glutamate. Now, glutamate is a neurotransmitter, and it makes you very intelligent. It makes you highly motivated. It makes you a go getter. And glutamate has to be turned into something called GABA, and GABA is relaxing. So many people supplement sometimes with GABA, and they'll find it relaxing, but I'll tell you why for some people it doesn't work. But glutamate needs to turn into GABA. B6 and ATP from energy production are cofactors for that conversion to occur. So the other thing we found in our Lyme study was that inside the mitochondria, and that is the energy of the cell, that's where the body takes your fats, carbohydrates, and proteins and turns it into energy, there was genetic variance higher in the chronic Lyme group that didn't make ATP. So as I've spoken to many of these people with chronic Lyme, even before they got ill, they were generally on the tired side. Specifically, there's genes that make carnitine, which carry fats into the cell. And then there's an ACAT gene, acetyl-CoA transferase, that takes your fats and proteins and turns that into acetyl-CoA, the first step of making energy. And then there's something called the electron transport, where we actually take that NADH and CoQ10 to make ATP. So we found higher amounts of genetic variants in the mitochondria. So that means they had lower amounts of ATP. They also had patterns where they made a little bit more glutamate. That's why, you know, so many of the people, but at least the ones who come to me, and that might be selectively because they learn about what we do and they have the, you know, financial resources to do it all. But I found that many of the people who had chronic Lyme were very intelligent, highly motivated, highly successful people because they had high glutamate. But because they have lower ATP production, and then when you get a pathogen like Lyme, it slows down the ATP production even more, so your glutamate to GABA conversion becomes compromised. So that's why many people, I think, are becoming anxious when they get Lyme, because their glutamate goes higher. Now, the anxiety would be enough, except that the glutamate, if it's not turned into GABA, will turn into peroxynitrite, a very oxidizing agent that suppresses the immune system. And you will find studies that shows that there's higher amounts of peroxynitrite in those with chronic Lyme. So that's the second shoe that can fall in those with chronic Lyme. Now, there's a third thing that we found in our phase one study, and there's something called NOS uncoupling. Now, there's a very important molecule called nitric oxide. A Nobel Prize was won, I believe, in the 1980s for the discovery of it. It's what dilates your blood vessels. It's what is related to your immune system, your neurotransmitters. And it comes from an amino acid called L-arginine. And L-arginine turns into nitric oxide if we have some other substances, specifically called BH4, and the NOS enzyme is working. So if we don't have enough BH4, again, from genetic issues or environmental issues, or if the NOS enzyme isn't working, rather than making nitric oxide, we make a free radical that eventually turns out to being peroxynitrite, which suppresses the immune system. And that's called NOS uncoupling, where rather than making the nitric oxide, and many times when I consult with people, I'll look at their genetic patterns and I'll say, any chance you have cold hands and feet? 95% of the time I'm correct. They say, yes, how did you know? Well, because rather than making nitric oxide, they're making a free radical that's chewing up their ability to detox and suppressing their immune system. And the fourth thing we saw in the Lyme study was there's a process inside the body called the urea cycle, U-R-E-A, that clears ammonia. And we found that many of these people had genetic patterns where they actually produced a little more ammonia, and we found genetic variants that their urea cycle was weakened. And consequently, they had high levels of ammonia, which creates brain fog, and then also depletes one of the nutrients that's needed to make your nitric oxide. So those are the patterns that we saw. Now, we've not drilled this down yet. That's one of the things we'd like to do, you know, from a research standpoint. You know, obviously not everybody has all of those. So what we'd like to do is do some statistical analysis, and hopefully someday I'll get some really, really smart mathematician as part of my research team who can look at what goes together. In other words, does the iron absorption and the inability to make glutathione, is that like one set? Is it the mitochondria and the glutamate that's another set? Is it the ammonia and the BH4 that's another set? So what I'm saying is there isn't like the pattern. There's multiple patterns, but they all lead to the same thing, and that is an inability to detox and weakened immune system. So that's what we found in phase one. And we can stop there, and then we can talk about phase two and phase three. But any questions, comments on what we found in phase one last year?
Yeah, I mean, it'd be great to go into phase two and three. It's fascinating. I think from what you've said about phase one, the two questions that have come up are, number one, how important is it for people to understand their genetic makeup and expressions before starting treatment? And then related to that, number two, if they're unable to do so financially or for whatever reason, prior to finding out about their genetic makeup and expressions, are there any supplements or activities that you would definitely recommend people do or people avoid?
Sure, sure, absolutely. Well, firstly, again, I go back to, I'm not a medical doctor, I don't treat the Lyme. So nothing genetically is probably going to make much difference on how you go about treating, whether you use antibiotics or whether you use herbals. So again, I go back to there's the treatment side of it, and then there's the environmental side of it. So I don't give any advice on, you know, how to treat the Lyme. Now, there's just a couple of things that makes it very helpful for you to know. You know, for example, here's why knowing genetically what's going on can be helpful. And again, not from a Lyme treatment standpoint, but from some of the complementary things that even some physicians do. One of the fascinating things that we found is that, you know, glutathione is, as we said, the master antioxidant. And there's many doctors who do what's called the Myers cocktail, which is a vitamin C and glutathione. And, you know, probably 98% of the people do very well on that. But what I found interesting was that when you have this Fenton reaction going on, okay, and you start giving someone glutathione, they might feel good for a very short period of time. And then all of a sudden they feel worse. And the physician giving that has no idea why that's happening. What I'm theorizing is that you are starting to spare the cysteine. Remember, cysteine turns into glutathione. Mm-hmm. And vitamin C helps you absorb iron. So if you take a lot of vitamin C and help you absorb more iron, despite starts making more hydrox, because then a glutathione vitamin C should be used cautiously, or be aware that it could backfire on you. Now, the other reason it's good to know is because many times people have, you know, irritated intestinal tracts, and it's well known that the amino acid glutamine is very, very helpful. However, when people have genetic patterns where they are making massive amounts of glutamate that's making them anxious and also making them inflamed, here is where glutamine can backfire on you. And where I'm getting at is we've now got to move towards personalized care. And in the medical world, you know, they're doing a lot of study on that in the CYPs, and in the veterinary world, we need to do that work as well. Because I've spoken to many people who have these genetic patterns, and I said, did you ever take glutamine? It's like, oh my God, yes, somebody told me to take glutamine for my gut, and I thought I was going to go out of my mind with anxiety, because the glutamine started turning into glutamate. And these people need to find a plan B for their, you know, for healing their gut, and there are other natural things that can help heal the gut. And for them, glutamine can be contraindicated. Now, I want to be very clear, I'm not opposed to glutathione therapy. I'm not opposed to glutamine for the gut. But as we get personalized, we can actually find where what can be helpful for one person can be harmful to another. And the same thing with N-acetylcysteine. When people are inflamed, it's like, okay, let's take some N-acetylcysteine to boost your glutathione. Well, if you've got genetic issues that cysteine is not converting to glutathione, and you throw more N-acetylcysteine in, you've just made more inflammation. And let me also talk about the iron. Interestingly, what we found is that some people can be over-absorbing their iron, and they have this Fenton reaction going on, and they actually are anemic, which just seems so contraindicated. So, you know, complex. It's like, how can that be? How can you absorb extra iron and be anemic? Well, if a large portion of your iron is making hydroxyl radicals, you can actually be doing that. And those are the folks, when I say to them, did you ever take iron? It's like, oh my God, yeah, I took iron. and I felt like I was burning up. I had to stop. So even in some instances of anemia, iron can actually be contraindicated. Now, when people have blood loss or other reasons, iron is absolutely life-saving. So I don't want anybody to take out of this. It's like, oh, don't take iron. I'm just pointing out in some instances when your iron is being overabsorbed and oxidized, the iron can actually put fuel on the fire. And then many people are anxious and someone tells them, oh, GABA's relaxing. Take some GABA. Okay. And then what happens is glutamate needs to turn into GABA. Well, if that conversion is not happening, or obviously it's happening, maybe it's not happening at 100%, maybe 60% or 70%, you can take GABA and your first response is, ah, I feel good. Then your GABA levels start coming up and your body says, thank you very much. I don't need to turn glutamate into GABA. The glutamate goes higher and you feel worse. And that's where people get so frustrated. It's like, why did something help me and then go south on me and make me worse? When you understand the biochemistry behind it, it makes total sense. So one of the things that we teach our clients about is how you can use nutrition to support glutamate to GABA conversion. How can you support cysteine to glutathione conversion? So if you boost your glutathione because you're making it rather than taking it, you're better. If you get your GABA because you're converting it rather than taking it, you're better off. So that's some of the ways that even nutrition can backfire on you, and that's why it's good to know this. So again, back from a medical standpoint, gosh, there isn't much I can tell people that, okay, now's the time to use drugs or not use drugs or which use drugs. I let the medical folks take care of that. I work on the detox side to make sure that the pathways are open. And then, as I said many times, medical doctors send folks to me. It's like, you know, I can't do anything yet. You know, talk to Bob, go through a 6-8 week protocol here where we support your ability to knock down the glutamate, knock down the inflammation, then go back in. Now, the other treatments that can be helpful or harmful is ozone and hydrogen peroxide. Ozone is O3. It kills pathogens. I mean, it's very, very effective. However, it does have to be cleared by the body, and there's certain genetic patterns that the ozone and or the hydrogen peroxide can actually backfire on you and make you more toxic. So those are the only ones, ozone and or hydrogen peroxide, which are not, you know, I don't think part of traditional medical care. They're more complementary. But there are patterns of glutathione, vitamin C, ozone, and hydrogen peroxide that they can actually work against you if you have a genetic pattern where some of those things are in excess. But as far as the drugs or the herbs, I don't think there's much we can tell genetically as to what's effective or ineffective.
And what genetic pathway specifically would be an issue then if you were considering IV ozone or...
Or hydrogen peroxide, yeah. Yeah, the hydrogen peroxide, it's important to know that hydrogen peroxide, you know, does kill pathogens. I mean, it does. However, if it gets in excess, it will combine with iron and or copper to make hydroxyl radicals. So we need glutathione and catalase to clear the hydrogen peroxide. I'm beginning to think that what I'm seeing a lot of is high hydrogen peroxide in many people who are chronically ill, that they have the inability to have catalase, because we can look genetically at catalase levels. We've now mapped out the entire glutathione pathway. And if someone is, you know, depleted in catalase and or glutathione, their hydrogen peroxide is high. Now, we've mapped out the iron genes, the HFE that cause you to absorb it, and this is in phase 3, the SLC40As that clear it out, but there's also a copper pathway as well, and our researchers are just working on that. So iron and or copper can create hydroxyl radicals. We're just in the infancy of the copper. But that's why if your hydrogen peroxide is already high and you've got dysregulation of your iron and or copper, there's the potential that hydrogen peroxide can backfire on you. I don't want to scare anybody away from using hydrogen peroxide. I mean, all you have to do is, you know, if you're feeling considerably worse, you know, work with your medical professional to decide if this is right for you. Again, I don't give anybody advice on what to do medically. But that is an instance where hydrogen peroxide could backfire. Same with ozone, O3, you need SOD to turn that into hydrogen peroxide. So the theory going out there, and it's just that, not fact yet, that if you're very depleted in SOD, ozone, be very careful with. If you're very depleted in catalase and glutathione, be careful with hydrogen peroxide. Now, again, you have to make decisions, and that's where your medical professional makes that decision. There may be more upside than downside. So perhaps the inflammation you get is a small price to pay for the effect of killing the pathogen. So I'm not in any way saying don't do that. I'm just showing where it can go wrong and where it can you know, create inflammation for you. And that's why when you have that genetic pattern that you don't clear hydrogen peroxide or you're lacking in SOD. So the solution may be, and again, may, I don't tell anybody what to what medical advice to follow, but perhaps what you want to do before you would do hydrogen peroxide is get your glutathione and catalase levels up so you can handle it better. For ozone therapy, it might be better to get your SOD levels up before you do that. So sometimes it's not only whether you do it or don't do it, it's timing and preparation. But again, we're such in the infancy of all of this, we're just beginning to learn. But that's why some people do well on ozone therapy and others crash. That's why some do well on hydrogen peroxide and others crash. That's why some people do well on, you know, glutathione infusions and others crash. That's why some people do well on N-acetylcysteine and others do poorly. So the more we can have this information in front of us, you know, the better off physicians who treat the Lyme will know, you know, what might be the best direction for them to go so they don't do any harm.
Which is fascinating, and there's definitely patterns with myself with the genetic expressions that I've got that are making a lot of sense from what you're saying. Are there any supplements that you would recommend to all chronic Lyme patients, regardless of their genetic variants, to either help them reduce symptoms or manage detox?
Sure. Well, you know, one of the safest things to do that, in my opinion, is never contraindicated, and that is to support hydrogen. The reason I go back to is so many of these pathways make hydroxyl radicals, OH-. Now, when I see a genetic pattern, I'll teach and educate people how, okay, maybe we need to support the glutathione to, or the cysteine to glutathione conversion. Maybe we need to take some NADH to recycle the glutathione. Maybe we need to take some SOD catalase. And then we customize that based upon the person. But if you don't have the pattern and you just, you know, can't do it or can't afford it, and you want to do something, my best advice would be hydrogen water. It's ridiculously simple. You know, from a biochemistry standpoint, the hydroxyl radical is an OH minus. Hydrogen is H2. OH minus plus H2 equals H2O. Like, how simple can you get? But the hydrogen will neutralize those hydroxyl radicals. I can't think at this point of any biochemistry reason why that's ever contraindicated. And there's companies out there that make capsules that you just drop in a bottle of water, and it fizzes for a little bit, knocks the hydrogen loose from the water, H2O, you know, it's two parts hydrogen, one part oxygen. And then it knocks the hydrogen loose, you drink the water, and then you are able to get hydrogen to the body. The only thing I've ever seen is if someone has a lot of yeast, it can create conditions that kills off the yeast and they can have a Herxheimer. But other than that, you're taking strain off the body. The other one that I think is likely never contraindicated is NADH, because NADH helps you recycle your glutathione, and it also helps make ATP. So kind of rare for that to happen. And if someone is fatigued, many times, remember I said earlier that carnitine is needed to carry your fats. It's called the carnitine shuttle. Mm-hmm. Carries the fats from outside the cell to inside the cell. And I recently heard a a very well-known doctor in functional medicine say that, you know, carnitine is associated with the welderly, which is the elderly that are well. And that's because the carnitine helps carry the fats from outside the cell to inside the cell. If they don't get carried in, they will create inflammation and low energy that can lead to the high glutamate. So carnitine supplementation in moderation, again, I can't think of any instance where carnitine would be contraindicated. Other than that, you kind of have to see the genetics. Now, a couple of food things that can be helpful. Just in case NOS uncoupling is going on, beets are excellent to help that carnitine production. I'm sorry, the nitric oxide production. So L-arginine needs to turn into nitric oxide. So if someone has cold hands and feet, or they're having some other things that might go along with low nitric oxide, like varicose veins at a, you know, an early age or something like that, drinking beet juice certainly can't do you any harm. And the nitrites in there, or the nitrates in there rather, support the production of your nitric oxide rather than the free radical superoxide. So without doing a genetic report, that's about the only things I can think of, and that is hydrogen, water, NADH, carnitine, and beets. Beyond that, you need the genetic report to actually see what might be most helpful.
That's fantastic. Thank you. And how about things like saunas and other lifestyle things? Are there ever any of those that would be contraindicated?
Well, no, I can't think of any, you know, unless you are in a chronically weak condition, and always, you know, check with your physician if you can handle sauna. But I'm a huge fan of sauna. I'm also a huge fan of ionic foot baths. And I should also mention there's a company called High Tech Health that now makes a device that creates hydrogen that you can breathe. And it's not the cheapest piece of equipment, but it makes hydrogen from distilled water. And then you can actually put a cannula on and breathe some of the hydrogen. It gets into the body faster. So you can drink the hydrogen water. You can breathe the hydrogen air. And saunas are excellent. And, of course, you know, just, you know, reducing the amount of pathogens you're exposed to. You know, check your house for mold. Be careful of the herbicide and pesticide exposure. If you're living in the country and you have a well, maybe some water purification would be wise, particularly if you have the PON1 genetic variants. Personal care products, you know, for example, many deodorants or antiperspirants rather have aluminum. You know, aluminum is an issue. So, you know, many times, and if there's chlorine in your water, perhaps simple things like a charcoal filter on your shower, you can be exposed to tremendous amount of chlorine by taking a shower if you have chlorinated water. So purify your water. And again, if you have what are called the PON1 variants, might be a good idea to eat organic or at least wash your fruits and vegetables extremely well so that you're limiting your exposure to those things. And of course, you know, don't smoke. And, you know, whatever you can to maybe get some air purifiers for the home. Drink purified water. Try to breathe as much clean air as you can. Don't put anything on the body that you wouldn't eat. You know, many of these chemicals that everyone else can detox from, you can't. So, you know, limiting your exposure to any toxins is a good idea. You know, if you are, you know, working with, you know, chemicals, make sure that you have good ventilation. Make sure that you always wear protective gloves and just simple things like that. And then finally, EMF. There is a set of genes called the CAC1AC that actually make people susceptible to electromagnetic fields. Invariably, when I see people that have a lot of homozygous on here, I'll say to them, do you ever, you know, feel like if you go to a mall where, you know, everybody's got a cell phone and every store has Wi-Fi, you just are anxious to get out of there, and it's like, uh-huh. And do you feel good going to the shore? It's like, oh, my God, I love the shore. Because their feet are in the sand. So, you know, one of the things we're just starting to look at is grounding and earthing and limiting your exposure. So, you know, don't having your cell phone right next to your bed is probably a good idea. Don't charge your cell phone next to your bed. Some people actually have to, you know, go back to a wired mouse or wired internet to limit their EMF exposure. The really nice thing about genetics is you can see if that's a problem for you. Because if you don't have those genetic variants, it's likely not. But you can now see through genetics if you are more predispositioned to having difficulty with electromagnetic fields.
And as genetic testing can really help personalised care, do you have any view on why it is that many Lyme doctors aren't integrating it more into their protocols?
Well, I mean, I can't speak for them, but firstly, it's very new.
Yeah.
I mean, we're just learning about this, and it's incredibly complex. I like to say this is like a 3D chess game played underwater. And if you're a busy physician who's treating the Lyme, you know, I can imagine how some of them would say this is just way too much. Now, what I've done, I've created an online education for physicians. And if someone goes to dnasupplementation.com, that's dnasupplementation.com, there's a link there for my online education. And the first three modules that are very extensive are free. So someone can listen to them and decide if it's for them. And many doctors are saying, boy, this is fascinating, I want to incorporate this. Many are saying, I just don't have the time to delve into this, because it is complex. For myself, as a traditional naturopath, this is all I do. I now don't do anything else but this. And it's complex. I mean, the report that we generate is 50 pages long with my software. For example, this weekend I'm teaching a class in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We're going to be lecturing from 9 a.m. to 6 p.m., 2 days, intensively training doctors how to do this. It's not easy. But the software I've developed, I'm trying to make it easier and easier. At the dnasupplementation.com, that's a website only for healthcare practitioners, not the public. But I'm developing software where I'm trying to put my knowledge into easy-to-use methods so that physicians can get a glimpse. I've actually just created something called a pyramid that will light up with different lights, and it will show the physician or the naturopath or, you know, the natural health practitioner where they need to offer support. It's important that you compare SNPs, labs, and symptoms, and we can talk about that as well, because you can't just treat the SNPs. But I'm trying to put that in, and someday I'd like to work with artificial intelligence where it can actually spit out a report and make it easier for the doctor. So for now, it's complex. And on my courses, the reason I give the first three free is because I tell people this is not for the faint of heart. You may look at this and decide way more than what I want to do, and that's okay. But hopefully as time goes on, perhaps, you know, physicians can have, you know, an assistant who's trained in nutrition and can learn how to do this. And I'm trying to, you know, train as many people as possible on how to analyze. That's why I created my own software that uses the genetic data and interprets it. And again, doesn't look at disease, doesn't treat anything, but shows how to support what I call the good guys and bad guys. We need the antioxidants. We need, you know, the folate. And we need to get rid of that excess glutamate, that excess peroxynitrite, that excess inflammation. Bring the body into balance using that traditional naturopathic philosophy of good things at good levels and bad things damped down. And as a side note, what I find with most people who come to me for a consultation, they've seen people who have said, oh, let me give you a little methyl B12, let me give you a little methyl folate, with disastrous results. Because what they try to do, they try to start moving pathways, and if the person is all inflamed, if their glutamate is high, if their histamine is high, that's another thing we could talk about, if their peroxynitrite is high, if their glutamate is high, you can't push pathways. And they get very, very sick. They get agitated, angry, inflamed, when they try to push pathways. So 90% of the people I work with, I use the analogy that when the house is on fire, you don't mow the lawn and paint the walls, you put out the fire. So for many people, our starting point is knocking down the histamine, knocking down the glutamate, knocking down the peroxynitrite, you know, knocking down all these inflammatory markers before we begin to build. So in an ideal world, physicians of not just Lyme, but, you know, because I think the same thing that causes Lyme disease causes Epstein-Barr, chronic fatigue, you name it. I mean, we're changing in our disease pattern. You know, 80 to 90 years ago, it was about bacteria because of sanitary things that we killed with antibiotics. Our health now seems to be changing to more inflammatory conditions, possibly exasperated by environmental issues. And we need to put an emphasis on supporting the antioxidants and the detox pathways.
Thank you. We'll include a link to the site with this video, so that if people want to feed it into their doctors and practitioners, they can do. So that, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, again, my website is for health practitioners only. It's unfortunately not for the general public, but it's for healthcare practitioners.
Yeah, so people can feed that through to their practitioners by the sounds of it. That's mm-hmm. great.
Yes.
You touched slightly there on how complex it is to interpret genetic results. Could you explain a little bit about what's involved in that, please, for people?
Sure. Well, you know, several years ago, myself included, we learned about MTHFR. And that is the gene that takes your folate from your diet and your folic acid from supplementation and turns it into methylfolate, which is the active form of folate. And again, I give, you know, my online education, I, you know, talk about the importance of folate. I mean, women need it for a healthy pregnancy. We need it to rebuild our new cells. Clearly, it's important. But what happened is, you know, a couple of years ago, we learned about MTHFR, and people started testing if people had the genetic variant in MTHFR. And they'd find it. It's called the MTHFR C677 and the A1298. And we were like, Eureka, we're going to help everybody by giving them methylfolate. Well, much to our chagrin, you know, a small amount of people were helped, but a larger amount of people felt great for 2 to 3 weeks. Then they either started to get anxious or they started to become inflamed. And what happened is that folate will stimulate glutamate production, and folate also makes new cells and stimulates phase one liver detox. So if you're high in glutamate, it's going to make you anxious. If you're low in glutathione, it's going to make you inflamed. So I created what I call the pyramid, where physicians can look at this, and there's a process to go through where you've got to, in my opinion, take care of the glutamate first. You've got to get the glutathione levels up. You may have to do many other things, NOS uncoupling, support the urea cycle, before you start looking at B12 and folate. So that's why it's complex, and the pyramid that I created starts with the gut. You know, many people who are ill have genetic issues that they can't handle gluten. They have genetic issues that they can't handle histamine. They have genetic issues that they can't handle oxalates, and their gut is inflamed. So before you start throwing folate and doing other things with people, you've got to work on the gut. The other thing that I've developed is that before you start pushing pathways, you need to get peroxynitrite under control. You need to get hydroxyl radicals under control. You have to get the person digesting their foods. You may have to do, you know, other things, gentle detox. And then after that, you start looking at the cofactors for methylation. And by the way, methylation is the turning off and on of every process. And there's this, you know, you'll find Facebook groups just on MTHFR, and everyone's talking about folate and the importance of methylation. I couldn't agree more, but you can't put the cart before the horse. Many times there's a lot of work you have to do first. If you just try to jump in and start giving someone folate and methyl B12 too soon, it can actually backfire on you. And I hear from people all over the country who, oh my gosh, I need to talk to you because my healthcare practitioner measured my MTHFR, gave me a massive amount of methylfolate, and oh my God, horrible, you know, anxious, inflamed. You know, one gentleman actually went to the hospital with seizures because they stimulated things too quickly. So genetically, there's an order you have to do things. I often talk about this is like an onion, unpeeling it layer at a time, and we can't jump too fast. What I teach doctors is that I'd rather be too late than too early. So most of the people that I consult with, when they have MTHFR, you know, they're all concerned about that. Oh my God, I have MTHFR. It's like, yeah, so does 40% of the population. And they want to jump, you know, they go on Google and they learn that they need folate, and they take folate much to their disappointment. Because, again, they can feel great for a period of time. It's like, woo-hoo, this is the answer. Woo-hoo is what I've been looking for. And then all of a sudden, crash, and they don't know why. Well, the why is because they've jacked up their glutamate, they've jacked up their need for glutathione, and they become anxious and inflamed. So you have to do things in the right order. You got to take care of the gut, knock down inflammation, knock down histamine. Because many people have a gluten issue and a histamine issue, and they make something called zonulin, which is setting them up for leaky gut and autoimmune disease, which would be a subject all of its own. But if you have that going on, you got to heal those things first. Or I shouldn't say heal, support those functions first. Then you move on to the next thing. Then you move on to the next thing. So my process that I teach doctors is, get the inflammation knocked down, get the glutamate knocked down, get the ammonia knocked down if those are problems. Then let's heal the gut. Then let's put in some cofactors, the B vitamins without B12 and folate, some minerals. Then stick our toe in the water with a little bit of methylfolate, then what I call, methyl B12 first, because if you don't have enough B12 before folate, you get what's called folate trapping. Then what I call fairy dust of methylfolate, not massive amounts, maybe a couple hundred micrograms, see how they do. And that's the process you have to go through. Now, if all you have is a folate problem and everything else is okay, boom, taking folate's your ticket. Most of the people who are really, really ill, that's not their problem. They've got multiple things going on, and you have to gently support them. So to circle back, I don't think the reason doctors are not doing it is because, firstly, it's so new. The education's not out there. It's very complex, and you need to spend a lot of time and a lot of effort, and that's why I created a certification course for doctors. And again, it has no CEUs. It's not medical. It's just, you know, a naturopath in Pennsylvania talking about, you know, what I have found. But I do have this certification course that doctors can go through that, you know, teach them what I've observed, because I like to say I have my PhD from the School of Hard Knocks, where I did that 5, 6, 7 years ago. I was giving people methylfolate and seeing those things. So that's what put me on my journey to find out what's going on, how can we prevent that. Then many doctors started coming to me and saying, what is it you're doing? So that's why I created my own software that does the analyzation and started the online course that teaches doctors what I've come up with so far. And I do have about 10, 12 physicians. It's not just me, the traditional naturopath. I have people with their PhD in biochemistry, medical doctors, acupuncturists, dietitians. They're all on my advisory board that help with, you know, creating a protocol here that hopefully will support the efforts of functional medicine physicians.
And would you see a similar issue with people that are supplementing with high vitamin D as well?
Well, yeah, that's a whole another subject. I mean, clearly we could give a whole lecture on the importance of vitamin D. And clearly, because of, you know, many factors, many of us are very low. One of the interesting things I found in my phase 2 study was that the BCMO1 genes, which is the beta-carotene to vitamin A genes, were more highly variated in those with chronic Lyme. And vitamin A is also needed for the immune system. And vitamin A is good for the skin, hair, nails, so it's going to be related to possibly to your gut and many functions. So beta-carotene needs to get turned into vitamin A. And interestingly, when I did a study of, you know, 1,300 genes and compared the Lyme group to the 1,000 Genome Project, that's another one that showed up, the vitamin A. Well, vitamin A hits the same receptor sites as vitamin D. So again, this is a question, not a statement, that needs research. You know, are we, again, focusing on something that's very important, overdoing it, and taking so much vitamin D? Is there a potential that we're depleting ourselves of vitamin A? Mm-hmm. And again, that's a question, not a statement, that we need to research. So what I usually do when people have a lot of genetic variants on their BCMO1 genes, I'll tell them may not be a bad idea to take some cod liver oil, because that's a nice source of vitamin A, and whatever vitamin D you're taking, double the amount every other day. That way, you're giving your body an opportunity for those cell receptor sites to absorb some vitamin A. Might that be right? I don't know, but it's certainly not going to do any harm. Just to give the body an opportunity to not overwhelm the cell receptor sites with all that vitamin D. So again, we learn about something, and then we tend to focus on it, just as we did with MTHFR. Methylfolate's very important. You got to have it. But the question becomes, have we, you know, gone a little bit overboard on it? I tend to think we do. People are measuring their methylfolate, their MTHFR. They're taking a lot of methylfolate. They might be taking too much. Same with vitamin D. I mean, vitamin D deficiency is a huge problem. We could lecture for an hour on the importance of vitamin D. Question becomes, and again, question, are we possibly, you know, tunnel vision, focusing on vitamin D too much? Perhaps, especially those who have difficulty with their beta-carotene genes, that they don't convert beta-carotene to vitamin A. So massive vitamin D supplementation has the potential to harm your vitamin A. So there can be too much of a good thing. So that's why, again, I go back to this is a 3D chess game played underwater.
Yeah, I'm really starting to understand that analogy now. Just to let everybody know that's listening, if you've got any questions, do pop them in below. We'll probably have time for a couple towards the end. So get those questions in now. And while we're waiting for people to put questions in, if with your clients you take this sort of step-by-step process of unravelling the onion layers, playing your underwater chess, are we able to get to the stage where we can actually stop certain genes expressing? A gene, can we turn them off as well as them being turned on, if you like?
Yeah, there's the $50,000 question. Now, keep in mind I'm a traditional naturopath. I'm not trained as a geneticist. So this is clearly the Bob Miller opinion as of March 21 or 22, whatever it is, subject to change. Now, what happens is, let's for example, talk about the histamine genes, the HNMT genes. The HNMT genes take histamine in the body and degrade it. And if that doesn't happen, that histamine can go high. And many people that are real have, you know, histamine mast cell issues. It creates inflammation through the body. Now, a cofactor for the HNMT is acetylmethionine. And SAMe is made through many, many processes. Lack of B12 will affect SAMe. Lack of trimethylglycine will affect SAMe. And interestingly, the hydroxyl radicals that are made from the Fenton reaction inhibit the production of SAMe. So from a standpoint of, you know, whether it's being expressed or not, here's where Bob Miller is as of today. When we have genetic variants on the HNMT genes, let's say, for example, your ability to degrade histamine might be 20%, 30%, 40%. I don't have an idea for sure, and I don't think anybody does. I tend to think when you've got those genetic variants, that's the way it's always been. Nothing's changed. Mm-hmm. So let's just theoretically say that the HNMT variants you have causes your histamine degradation to be decreased 20%. But when you get a pathogen like Lyme, and that affects your ATP. ATP is a cofactor for what's called methionine to SAMe conversion. Remember, SAMe is what helps with the HNMT gene to break it down. So anything that comes along epigenetically that would reduce your production of SAMe, being, you know, lower ATP, stop eating eggs where you get your choline, or you get these hydroxyl radical formations going on that inhibit the SAMe, you've now dropped your SAMe production. So if you drop your SAMe production, your ability to clear histamine has now been degraded even more. So what we're saying is, okay, now we've changed the expression, and at least from a traditional naturopath's understanding as of today, I tend to think it's the epigenetics that is changing that makes it look turned on or off. So if you don't have any SAMe, your HNMT genes are not going to work. So if you raise the ATP, if you get the hydroxyl radicals knocked down, then you're going to start making SAMe, then your HNMT genes are going to clear histamine more effectively. That's where I am today. I wouldn't be surprised if some, you know, geneticist who's really, you know, on top of this more than I am comes along and says, you know, no, Bob, that's not quite right because of whatever. I'm open to that. But that's just one of the things that I'm seeing today, one of the theories I have, mm-hmm. that it's the epigenetic things that alter maybe the cofactor. So, for example, you need a mineral to be a cofactor for, you know, enzyme to make substance A into substance B, and you all of a sudden don't get that mineral anymore, then it appears to be expressed. Maybe I'm oversimplifying. Perhaps someone could elucidate on this even more. I think what I'm saying is correct. There might be more to it, and that's what we don't know, is there are more to it. But that's where I am at the moment. Subject to revision, of course, as we learn more.
Oh, well, it's always the way, isn't it, with science? Now, I know you don't treat Lyme disease itself and the co-infections, but taking into account what we know about people that may be predisposed genetically and the increase in environmental toxins, if somebody has confirmed or suspected Lyme disease, do you think there's a good case for treating before they become, you know, even if they're not too symptomatic now, if they've got confirmed or suspected Lyme, do you think there's a good case for treating it, given the genetic and environmental toxic world we're in?
Well, again, I go back to, you know, personalized medicine, and again, that's a decision they have to make with their licensed medical professional. The, you know, one of the concerns about, you know, treatment with particularly strong antibiotics is that, you know, they're absolutely life-saving, but they can, you know, upset the genome. So if someone already has a very, very fragile intestinal tract, you may want to give more thought to, you know, do you want to be, you know, preventative with antibiotics? And again, that's out of my scope of practice. But I just throw that out as a, you know, again, personal, you know, for personalized medicine. Yeah. You know, if someone, you know, has a healthy gut, they have no history of candidiasis, they have no history of yeast, you know, it may make more sense to be aggressive with antibiotics with that person than the person whose lifetime, because I've seen people, you know, have very fragile intestinal tracts, and antibiotics have done tremendous damage. And if that wouldn't be necessary, that would be unfortunate. But again, that goes back to personalized. I think we've got to get to a point that we don't make blanket statements, that we don't say, do this or don't do that. As we progress in our knowledge, we're going to be able to say, you know, let's do this for this person, let's be cautious for that person. But again, I never give any advice on whether or not to do medical treatment. But just from a research standpoint, that might be some of the things we're looking at. What is the risk reward? And, you know, what is the risk if we, you know, treat aggressively even though we don't know, versus, you know, what is the reward? And each person is going to be different, and I'm sure that decision would be different based upon each person.
Of course, of course. And we've got some questions coming for the group, which is, I think the answer will be it does depend on the person, but do you have any recommendations for people that have got gut problems, leaky guts, and or sulfur intolerance?
The last part was sulfur intolerance?
Yeah, sorry. So gut issues, leaky gut, and or sulfur intolerance. What would you consider with a client?
Yeah, well, I'll take them separately. One of the first things in my online course for doctors is to look at the gut. And so far we've identified a couple of things, and I'm sure this is not completely inclusive. But the first things we look at in my genetic report is the gluten genes. And I'm stunned how many people who are chronically ill have genetic variants that they don't break down gluten very effectively. Now, there's a whole other argument of, you know, how we're processing our foods and what we're putting on it. Could that be worsening it? And we don't have time to get into that. But I just see many people that the first thing they've got to do is cut gluten. Now, the nice thing about a genetic report is it tells you whether it's a potential issue or not. I'm sure there's some people that have cut gluten that probably don't have to. Not that gluten is good for us, but, you know, the first thing is if people have a lot of genetic variants with gluten, my recommendation is they go 100% gluten-free. Not gluten-light, gluten-free. Then the other thing we have to look at is what is called the ABP1 genes. And these are the genes that make the dynamine oxidase. That is the enzyme that breaks down histamine. And there's a lot of confusion out there. Some people are doing their genetic testing, and they're looking at the DAO genes and saying, oh, I've got variants there. I don't make enough DAO enzyme. It's being repeated on the internet quite often. It's easy to understand why it's confusing. The DAO genes do not make the DAO enzyme. The ABP1 genes make the DAO enzyme. So a lot of people have genetic variants there. So they don't make the enzyme that breaks down histamine foods. So what happens is I see many people who have genetic variants that they don't make the genes that allow them to break down gluten. Then they also have genetic variants that don't allow them to break down histamine. There's two components to that. There's the ABP1 gene that makes the DAO enzyme, and then there's the HNMT gene that causes them to actually break down histamine in their foods, or the histamine inside their body. Some combination of that, you know, it's usually the gluten, the ABP1, and the HNMT. Invariably, these people have gut issues. They've got to go gluten-free, histamine light, and take a DAO enzyme whenever they have a histamine food. And I don't know if we heard this or not, but you know, many people have gut issues, and some well-meaning practitioner or friend says, oh, you need to eat more fermented foods. So they eat more sauerkraut, they eat more miso, they have more kombucha, and it actually makes the situation worse because it makes zonulin that creates leaky gut. And I was just saying when we had the technical difficulty, I've yet to see an individual, again, just Bob Miller clinically, not any study, I've yet to see anybody with Hashimoto's disease that doesn't have usually some combination of gluten and histamine. So going gluten-free, histamine light. And there's an interesting little test you can do. It's quite fascinating. And let's see, my video is on, so people are seeing me, correct?
Yes, yep, I can see you.
Okay. Yeah, what you can do is you can just take your arm and take your fingernails and scratch fairly hard over a period of an area of the skin. And if a bunch of white lines come up that stay there, like you took a piece of chalk, there is the potential that your histamine is very high. And then you know that you've got it. But the other thing to look at is, you know, do you have overreaction to spring and fall allergies? Does a glass of wine just, you know, set you off? Now, that can be a sulfite issue as well. Or do you not do well on histamine foods? So that can be one way to see if you have a histamine issue. And the other way is to take 50 milligrams of niacin on an empty stomach. And if you flush, if you get all red, if the red just comes up through you and you get itchy skin and you feel like something very weird is happening to you, firstly, relax. It's just a niacin flush. But there's an inverse relationship between niacin and histamine. So if you, because niacin chews up methyl groups. So again, that's another issue. We've learned about niacin being good for the HDLs. So many people are taking all this niacin and they're knocking down their methyl groups and they're impacting their methylation process. Different subject. But that's how you can see if you are having excess histamine. When you get those white lines, a lot of spring and fall allergies, negative reactions to high histamine foods. So you have to go on a gluten-free, low histamine, possibly take a DAO enzyme whenever you have a histamine food to heal the gut. Now, the sulfites. You had asked about those, and some people don't do very well on sulfites. This is an area that we're still researching, and one of the pieces of information out there is people are looking at the CBS genes, the cysteine betaine synthase, and they tend to think if you have genetic variants there, you shouldn't eat sulfur foods. At this point, I tend to think that's a bit of an oversimplification because we do need sulfur foods to make our glutathione. What I've generally found is that when people are having trouble with sulfur, many times they're low in what's called trimethylglycine, TMG. If I would have thought ahead here, I would have had the methylation map that I could share on the screen here. But what happens is we need trimethylglycine to take a substance called homocysteine and recycle it back. We also need B12 and folate for that. And if we're low in the trimethylglycine, and we can be because we can have genetic variants that we don't make enough choline, they're called the PEMT genes. And if you have PEMT variants, you don't make choline, then you don't make trimethylglycine, so therefore you don't move homocysteine back into methionine. Well, when that occurs, the CBS can be overactive, and you can be having, you know, reactions to sulfur, making more ammonia, making more sulfites, more sulfates, more cortisol. So I think we're just being oversimplifying a little bit if we say, oh, the solution is just don't eat sulfur foods. Many times we need to support the SUOX gene, and molybdenum does a very good job of doing that. But also we might need a little bit of choline or trimethylglycine so things don't rush down too quickly. The other area that, you know, I'd like to research, and again, we're just in a research phase on this, you know, sulfur compounds is needed to make your glutathione. If someone doesn't convert those sulfur compounds into glutathione, it may be possible, and again, just that thing, that if we support that conversion into glutathione, we might tolerate sulfur foods a little bit better. So very, very preliminary. But again, I go back to we're just in the infant stages of learning this. I'd like to partner with some universities to actually do some research on this, see who has the genes, look at their cysteine, cystine, sulfite, sulfates, you know, do different interventions. So that's some of the stuff that hopefully is coming down the pike somewhere. But that's why people don't tolerate sulfur, because I'm thinking that perhaps they're not recycling their homocysteine, they're not converting their sulfur into glutathione, they may have trouble taking their sulfites, turning it into sulfates, they may not be clearing the ammonia, which again goes back to no easy, quick answers. We don't have magic bullets here, and we have to do a lot of research.
No, that makes a lot of sense. Before we go to the final question, you've touched on phase two and three of your research. Have you just got anything you wanted to add about what you've submitted and what you're going to talk about at the ILADS conference in May?
Sure. Well, in phase two, which was in Philadelphia, we found, interestingly, that many people with chronic Lyme had more genetic variants in their dopamine receptor sites. And quite frankly, we haven't done much research on that. Other, we found that when dopamine gets into some of these receptor sites, it's involved with the immune system and knocking down IL-4 and IL-6 cytokines, which are inflammatory. And we found more glutamate genes as well. We found it. We reported it. We really don't even know what to do about it yet, other than there's a neurotransmitter component likely. I literally just finished up phase three. I sent it to ILADS to present in Paris in May. Because as I mentioned, my iron research was an award-winning research project in June of last year, and I'm hoping that we'll get the same recognition for this one. What we found, interestingly, was that in addition to the iron genes being variated, there's a process inside the body called NRF2. Oh, before I go on that, let me also mention, we looked at the SLC40A1 genes that are responsible for taking iron out of the cells. So we found that those with chronic Lyme had a higher chance of having the genes that absorb extra iron, higher chance of having genetic variants in the genes that take iron out of the cell. Now, what we're theorizing is that excess iron in the cell causes inflammation. Now, inside the cell, we have something called the NRF2 KEAP1 ARE pathway. A quick analogy to that is that when you're in a building, there's many times sprinkler systems in the ceiling. And the sprinkler sits there with a pipe behind it with water in it. And it does nothing until there's a fire. And when there's a fire, the sprinkler releases what's called the NRF2 that then stimulates what's called the ARE, antioxidant response element, to release your three major antioxidants, SOD, glutathione, catalase, inside the cells to knock down the inflammation. Interestingly, we found a higher amount of genetic variants in the NRF2 and KEAP1 genes in those with chronic Lyme. Anecdotally, I've just seen now three people who have a double variant on one of the KEAP1s that were extremely ill, would not respond to treatment. Again, just anecdotal, not a study, but that's one of the areas that I'd like to work with some universities. You know, does some homozygous variants on this keep one? So keep one is like the sprinkler that holds the water back. Nerve 2 releases it. So if you have genetic variants in keep one, an analogy would be that when there's a fire in the building, the sprinkler doesn't go off. There's water in the pipes, but the sprinkler doesn't go off. So what we're presenting in, what we want to present if it's accepted as a research paper, that in addition to having excess absorption of iron, inability to take the iron out, the sprinkler system, so to speak, in the cells might be ineffective to put out the inflammation, causing cellular mitochondrial dysfunction and inflammation. Again, just a theory at this point. I'd love to partner with some universities, but it's something we need to look at. So one of the things we're working on is trying to find nutritional ways to support the NRF2 keep one pathways. If you go on PubMed and you type in NRF2, NRF2, or keep one, KEAP1, thousands of scientific studies. The universities are putting a lot of time into studying the NRF2 keep one pathways and how it relates to tamping down inflammation, which takes us back to where we started. If we're getting extra environmental toxins that are creating inflammation, might it be that those with these genetic variants are the proverbial canary in the mine? You know, back many years ago, miners would take a canary with them because if the oxygen levels started going down, the canary would die first, and they knew that they needed to get out of there. So the theory we're proposing is those who have the overabsorption of the iron, inability to take it out, lowered antioxidant capacity in the cell, are they the proverbial canary in the mine that's allowing them to be more impacted by these epigenetic factors? Again, no statements here, no claims, just things that we need to research, and it's very exciting as we can move forward with this and hopefully find some things that'll, you know, help those individuals who may have that genetic pattern.
Yeah, lots of exciting areas to research, and best of luck with the iLADS award this year. Just one very quick question before we wrap up, and that is, what would you say to someone who felt that there was no way out of the situation they're in with chronic Lyme disease?
Sure. Well, you know, I talk to a lot of people every day who are there, and the relief they get when I tell them, oh, you have some carnitine issues here that you don't, you know, get your carnitine in. Oh, it looks like you're not converting your cysteine to glutathione. Looks like you're absorbing a little more iron. Oh, it looks like you're not clearing the ammonia. The relief that they get is incredible. I mean, many people break down in tears of, oh my gosh, you mean there might be some hope. And I tell my staff that, we're really not in the supplement business or the genetic business. We're in the hope business. And many people are so relieved to know that there's finally some help, because when every medical intervention doesn't work, and then you see a natural health practitioner and everything they tell you to do makes you worse, it can get very discouraging. And that's why I'm so passionate about doing the genetic testing, because many times I've helped people tremendously by not giving them something, but by taking them off of things. You know, if someone's on iron and cysteine and eating, glutamine to heal their gut, and they've got these genetic variants, they're making themselves worse. So sometimes I do more help by just saying, I think this may not be a good idea. Or if you've got overabsorption of iron and you're taking massive amounts of vitamin C that helps you absorb more iron, many times inadvertently, and the people who told them to do this were well-meaning based upon clinical knowledge. I mean, these are not bad things to do, but in certain individuals, again, back to personalized, it can be wrong for them. So that's why I'm trying my best to get the word out, training doctors, you know, things to look for, because I can't possibly talk to everybody who wants to talk to me. I get so many requests today, we're actually having to filter people. So I want to spend my time training other people how to do this so they can help others more effectively. So back to your question, for those who are, you know, just really hitting rock bottom, there really is hope. And I don't want to give false hope, because I tell people that there's no magic bullet here. I don't have the miracle in the bottle. I don't have the supplement that is the solution. it's a long, arduous process where you might have to make dietary changes, lifestyle changes, unpeel these layers layer at a time. But we've seen many people's health improve, not by treating the disease, but by helping them clear those toxins, get rid of that gluten if they have that problem, getting rid of the excitatory foods if that's happening, maybe altering the amount of sulfur foods they're eating. I tell people that, you know, this is not going to be easy. You know, we don't have, you know, if somebody tells you they have the magic bullet, run because you're about to get scammed. It's a long, arduous process that's not for the faint of heart, but for those willing to put the time and effort into it. We've seen many people, you know, regain wellness by not treating the disease, you know, seeing their doctor for that, but working on the environment inside the body that's compromised due to genetic and epigenetic factors.
And I guess where so many protocols and research, it might work for the majority of people. This is exactly where the personal care comes in for those 20% or whatever it might be that are different to the norm.
Mm-hmm. And that's where we're going. All the conferences I'm at, everything's moving towards, we've got to have personalized. Again, even in the medical world, they're looking at a lot of the CYP genes to find where, you know, one drug might be excellent for one person, but it might be contraindicated for the next. And that's an exciting area in the medical world that I'm not part of, but it's also exciting in the natural health world to find where some substances may be helpful and some substances might be harmful. And I think that's why when studies have done, you know, on natural things, they've come back mixed. Well, because, for example, you know, they did a study on beta-carotene. Well, they stopped it because it made some people worse. Well, but I would supposition if we went back, the people who did worse probably had the genetic issues. They didn't convert the beta-carotene to vitamin A, so they got hyper beta-carotene and they got worse. So we can't conclude from that that beta-carotene is bad, but it would be bad for those people who don't convert. And that's why just doing a study on just random people probably gives mixed results. And as we're able to do studies, so for example, if someone doesn't have the beta-carotene genes and you give them beta-carotene, they probably improve. For those who have the genetic variants, give them beta-carotene will make them worse. And acetylcysteine, if you convert it into glutathione, will make you better. And acetylcysteine, if you don't convert and you have excess iron, could likely make you worse. So that's why we need to move into a new paradigm of not only personalized medicine, but personalized nutrition.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you both for giving, I'm sure, people that have got tough to treat cases a lot of hope with that. And also for the time you've given us today. It's been invaluable. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Oh, thank you. It's really, really is appreciated from us all. What we'll do is we will share the links that you've shared with us when we put this onto our website and also in the group, so that people that are listening in live now have those as well.
Sure. I'd also like to mention that that I have videos on my Phase 1 Lyme study at nutrigeneticresearch.org. I actually did a video on my Phase 1 study.
Brilliant. We'll find those and put links to those as well then. Brilliant.
Fantastic.
Thank you so much. Now, and brilliant way to start the day with you. And so enjoy the rest of your day and thank you so much for your time.
Okay, it's been my pleasure.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye-bye now.